Just before we get started with today's video, I do want to thank Brilliant for sponsoring it. To support Today I Found Out and learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/brainfood and sign up for free. Contrary to popular belief, space isn't actually cold per se, at least not in the way that it's often depicted in the movies. Space is just mostly empty and all that nothing, it doesn't have temperature. For example, if you were in space without a spacesuit, which is a bad idea by the way, the two ways you'd lose heat are just via evaporation of moisture on your skin, in your mouth, etc., and then the much slower way via radiating heat away. This would take a really long time. In fact, if you were in direct sunlight at around the Earth's orbit distance from the Sun, that's 1 AU or astronomical unit, you'd find yourself overheating pretty darn quickly, likely with severe sunburns in just a few minutes. Now this all brings us to the topic of today, and that's, if space isn't cold, why did the astronauts on Apollo 13 get so cold in their spaceship? And then the other question is, well, when things got really chilly, why didn't they just put on their spacesuits? To begin with, somewhat counterintuitively, the reason their ship got so cold so fast is precisely because it's troublesome to get rid of heat on a spacecraft. With all the equipment on board the ship generating heat, as well as the extra heat absorbed when the ship is in direct sunlight, this would normally see the astronauts baking inside of the craft. To get around that problem, the ships were specifically designed to radiate heat away very quickly in order to compensate. Just in case this cooling thing happens too quickly, for example when not in direct sunlight, the ship was also equipped with heaters, which would keep the astronauts comfortable. Thus, during the Apollo 13 mission, when all of the equipment was off and they couldn't spare power to run the heaters, they were left with a ship designed to radiate heat away relatively quickly, even when in sunlight, but there was nothing but their own bodies and sunlight generating heat. The net effect was that it got really cold inside the command module and the LEM. This brings up the logical follow-up question, and that's, when it got cold, why didn't they just use their spacesuits to keep warm? In search of a definitive answer, we discovered a variety of speculative explanations online, many of which get surprisingly technical and ultra-specific, despite the fact that nobody was using a definitive source and they were simply speculating. Further, nowhere in any of the Apollo 13 transcripts we read does the idea of the astronauts putting on their spacesuits seem to have come up, despite the cold. Unsatisfied with going with speculative explanations, we eventually resorted to mailing a letter to Fred Hayes to get a more definitive answer, with unfortunately no response. Unwilling to give up, we continued to dig and finally managed to track down a May of 1970 Life magazine article in which all three astronauts gave their accounts of what happened during the Apollo 13 mission. A fascinating read, most notable to the topic at hand in that article, is the following from Jim Lovell concerning the cold, which finally gave us the definitive answer we were looking for. "Eventually, it dawned on me that somehow we all had to get some sleep, and so we tried to work out a watch system. We weren't very successful. Besides, the inside of the Odyssey kept getting colder and colder. It eventually got down pretty close to freezing point, and it was just impossible to sleep in there. Fred and I even put on our heavy lunar boots. Jack didn't have any, so he put on extra long johns. When you were moving around, the cold wasn't so bad, but when you were sitting still, it was unbearable. So the three of us spent more and more of our time together in Aquarius, which was designed to be flown by two men standing up at that. There wasn't really any sleeping space for two men in there, let alone three, so we just huddled in there trying to keep warm and doze off by turns. We didn't get any sleep in the true sense of the word. We considered putting on our heavy spacesuits, but the suits were so bulky that they would compromise our maneuverability in an emergency situation, and when you put on the suit, you were bound to perspire a lot. So you'd be all wet and cold too, an invitation to pneumonia." It's also noteworthy here that in a separate interview, NASA engineer and man in charge of the spacecraft warning system during Apollo 13, Jerry Woodfill, stated that nobody on the ground was terribly concerned about the astronauts being cold or getting hypothermia. With what they were wearing and the temperature inside the spacecraft, they were cold, but not critically so, and everyone had much bigger problems to deal with. You see, as you might have gleaned from the previous passage by Lovell, it turns out the otherwise phenomenal Apollo 13 film took some liberties, and it was not, in fact, ever cold enough to do something like tap frozen hot dogs against the wall. In fact, according to that same Life magazine article, Jack Swigert stated, "Aquarius was a nice warm 50 degrees. He further went on to state that it was 38 degrees in the Odyssey before re-entry. To translate for the rest of the world, that means it was about 10 degrees Celsius in Aquarius and about 3.8 degrees Celsius in the Odyssey. Cold, particularly in the Odyssey, but with what they were wearing, not unbearably so for two of the three crew members, especially when spending as much time as possible in the Aquarius. As for the third, Fred Hayes did have a lot of trouble with the cold, likely due to a fever owing to his urinary tract infection. He stated in his own account in that Life magazine interview, "I've been a lot colder before, but I've never been so cold for so long. The last 12 hours before re-entry were particularly bone-chilling. During this period, I had to go up into the command module. It took me 4 hours back in the LEM before I stopped shivering. Because of the cold, during the last two nights, I slept in the tunnel between the two vehicles with my head in the LEM and with the string of my sleeping bag wound around the latch handle of the LEM hatch so that I wouldn't float around." So I've got some good news for you. It's unlikely that you're ever going to need to use your knowledge of science out to figure out why you're not warm in a spaceship on the way back from the moon. But science and maths knowledge, it's still a great thing to have, and that's why today's sponsor is Brilliant. You've heard me talk about Brilliant before, but perhaps with not such a smooth transition. They're a learning platform that focuses on active learning. This is where you are given a short bit of information on a scientific concept and then are asked to solve a problem based on that information. This is an incredibly effective way to learn, as well as lots of courses on everything from basic physics of the everyday to quantum objects. They also have daily challenges. These are just 5 minutes a day that you can use to exercise your brain and learn something new. Thousands of people on Brilliant have learned how to use computer science to efficiently bake cheese biscuits, calculate the area of a snowflake, and even return safely from the moon. Okay, not that last one, but there's lots of cool challenges, believe me. Each problem provides you with the context and framework that you need to tackle it. That means you can learn concepts by applying them. That is, of course, that active learning. This sort of daily practice can lead you from curiosity to mastery in far less time than you would think. So go to brilliant.org/brainfood and finish your day a little smarter. The first 200 people to do so will get 20% off their annual subscription, and you'll also be able to see all of the problems in the archives. And now for a bonus fact. Speaking of spacesuits and Hollywood myths, in movies you'll often see humans exposed to the near vacuum of space doing things like suddenly exploding or instantly freezing in the supposed extreme cold of space. But in fact, so long as you don't try to hold your breath, which would result in your lungs rupturing and thus pretty well guarantee that the incident would be fatal, what will actually happen is you'll remain conscious for about 10 to 15 seconds. After that, you'll be fine as long as you're placed back in a pressurized environment within about 90 seconds. It's even possible that some might last as long as 3 minutes, as chimpanzees are capable of this without suffering any lasting detrimental damage. For significantly more detail on this and how we know these numbers, do check out our video, "How Long Can You Survive in Space Without a Spacesuit?" where we answer that question. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Do not forget to subscribe for brand new videos just like this every day of the week. And as always, thank you for watching.